Inspired by the life of the savvy and ambitious Colombian businesswoman Griselda Blanco comes a new Netflix original limited series. Griselda tells the story of a devoted mother who, with her lethal blend of charm and relentless savagery, creates one of the most powerful cartels in history. Witness Sofia Vergara's captivating transformation into the godmother of the underworld. Griselda, now streaming only on Netflix.
I'm Mo Rocca, and I'm excited to announce season 4 of my podcast, Mobituaries. I've got a whole new bunch of stories to share with you about the most fascinating people and things who are no longer with us. From famous figures who died on the very same day, to the things I wish would die, like buffets. All that and much more. Listen to Mobituaries with Mo Rocca, wherever you get your podcasts.
Burn again, ABCs.
Welcome to the Burn Again ABCs, where we discuss every song from 7 to Y. And when we hit the... Sorry, half the words on that screen showed up and said, when we hit the kids... And I was when we hit the kids' songs, we always have my children on for their opinions, but never my big sister. Why? Because, well, I don't have a big sister. But I am happy to report that we do have Jeff and Aaron joining us tonight. Thank you, gentlemen.
Hey!
And we may have Heidi jumping in later on or sending us her thoughts, because I really wanted to keep her going on us.
We may have our big sister. We may not. Yes. We don't know. Yeah.
I think I'm older than she is, so I don't know. Yeah. I wouldn't call her a big sister.
Our sister, though. Let's say that.
Oh, and I just spilled. Hold on. Keep going. I'll be right back.
Oh, my gosh. Keep going with what? What are you doing here?
It was a dark and stormy night, and on the door handle there was a hook.
So tonight's song was written by Ed. Tonight we're going to be discussing My Big Sister.
I like my big sister, but I don't want to wear her coat. Maybe black, it may fit perfect, but you and I both know it's a girl's coat.
Aaron, do you know what album this is on?
You know, I'm going to go for a wild guess and say Snack Time.
No.
You got it.
No. This is actually on Maroon.
I'm Maroon.
Yeah, it's right after Off the Hook. tonally similar.
I don't even know how to respond to you saying that. You have just floored me. But while I try to recover, Aaron, will you give us a breakdown?
Yeah, let's break it down. So My Big Sister was recorded at approximately 158 beats per minute. Time signature is debatable here. I'm going to say it's in 3/4. It kind of feels more like 6/8 or 12/8 at times. But if it were, that would require the occasional additional measure of 3/4 thrown in to make it work due to the structure of the song. If this were Radiohead, I'd be inclined to believe that's exactly what's going on. But I'm happy to just kind of call it 3/4 and leave it at that. I think 3/4 is probably how I would count it if I were performing it. It's in the key of E minor. The vast majority of the song revolves around the resolution from the fourth degree to the tonic, with the minor third being a common stepping stone from the tonic to between the tonic and fourth. So the A section is simply E, which is your one or tonic, to G, your minor third, to A, which is your perfect fourth, and then back to E. With the subsequent time through the A section having an extra go between G and A. So instead of E, G, A, E, you get E, G, A, G, A, E. So this is basically 1-3-4. The B section simply takes the same three chords and changes the order. So we start on the G, then go to A, then resolve to the tonic E, which is 3-4-1. And it's a very simple structure. It's pretty much A, A, B, which appeals to my sense of vanity because those are my initials. Simple song, but it's an interesting song. I kind of like it. Obviously, it's in a minor key, so that appeals to me. It's got this kind of, I don't know, it kind of reminds me a little bit of Cats in the Cradle. Mm-hmm. Musically, not necessarily lyrically. Although there is a theme of growing up. So, a little bit of a Venn diagram, kind of coincidence there. But yeah, that's pretty much it. Very simple song. Mostly the acoustic guitar and the voice. There's not too much going on musically. But it's well done, and it's kind of enigmatic because of that minor key.
Well, there is some other stuff that's going on with this song, though, that when you really kind of take the time to listen, they throw some extra stuff in as it goes on. So first of all, I do want to give credit where credit is due. So Brian McMillan is on the lap steel guitar on the song. And it's very interesting. They finish the song. Well, I'll come back to that. So you're right. It starts very basic. It starts, if you haven't heard this song before, here's a quick snippet. That was only about 2 seconds.
You probably could have played the whole song right there, actually.
I would have gotten sued if we'd done the whole song, but I probably could have.
You probably wouldn't have.
It's only 54 seconds long. It's a very dark sounding song, but I think it's kind of neat that, like, Ed's voice starts off very sweet sounding, but then at the end of each line, it starts to get a little bit more sour. It starts to get a little bit more dour with what he's saying.
Well, and it's got those heavy stings, too, between, like, the stanzas.
Yeah.
It's
going, when you land on the tonic. Yes. It's very, very kind of, I don't even know what the word I would choose would be, but it's very definitive and it's resolute.
Well, and after that second one, you actually get that, and I want to say it's the lap steel guitar with that really high squeal that comes in.
Yeah.
That's kind of interesting. It feels like he's trying to increase tension on this kid's song, this really short kid's song. But the other thing that really kind of shocked me was the tympanic booms. Like, I'm guessing that's what Tyler was playing here. It doesn't sound like a bass drum. It sounds like he's hitting a timpani on those big stings.
Yeah, it could be. It's very, very like booming, and it's very like I said, it's resounding, and it's well. So we'll get into this, I'm sure, when we talk about the lyrics. But one of the things that I've tried to do as I become older, rapidly hurtling towards 40 now, but I've always tried to hold on to the understanding of what it was like to be a child, because I have this theory that it's kind of like the idea that a fish will grow as large as the tank it's in will allow it. Your problems kind of fill the space that you occupy. So when you're a child, it's easy for us as adults to say, oh, it's not a big deal, it's not a big problem. But when you're in that space and when you're in that mindset and mentality and environment where this is your whole world, that can be a huge deal. And like getting picked on or you know, anything that increases the odds of you getting singled out as a child, I think can be something you would definitely want to avoid. So it can feel quite heavy, which is why I think they kind of went for that kind of feel in the music.
Aaron, did you have to wear a lot of hand-me-down clothes?
I did. No, I didn't have. I didn't have a big sister. I am the middle child, the second child specifically, and I had a big brother, or I have a big brother and a little sister. So I did have a lot of hand-me-downs from my older brother, but I never had to deal with hand-me-downs from an older sister. So now I don't want to get too bogged down into a contemporary reading of this song. I admit I spent a little time trying to drill down into it to search for a deeper meaning, but let's face it, it's from Snack Time. I think it's pretty literal. I have to wonder, does Ed actually have an older sister? Is this autobiographical to a certain extent?
Yes. So Ed actually Ed is the youngest of 5 children. He has 2 older sisters, Lynn and Bonnie, and 2 older brothers, Bill and Doug.
Okay. So this could have been him kind of getting into that mind space and then decide, you know, hey, we're going to make a children's album. Why don't I talk about this thing that I went through as a kid?
Or, hold on, I'm going to take 30 seconds here. and double check my facts before I say this, because then I'm going to sound stupid, but I believe I'm correct on this. Okay, so yes, so his first child was Hannah, his second child was Lyle, and the third child was Arden. So both of his younger kids had a big sister. So again, this and was, I mean, they were born in 95, 99, and 2002. So they were younger at this point. This could have been based off from as well his discussions that he heard quite often at his own home from his own kids as well, which may have helped him be like, yeah, I remember that feeling. The other thing musically that I think is really important to note is the hums at the end of the song is really an interesting direction to go in. Like, we don't have the guys in the rest of the song for the majority of the 54 second song, but then the very end, like, they're in there doing those at the end, which is kind of a neat country western type thing.
Yeah, I mean, if you took just the music from this and set it to like footage from No Country for Old Men or something, I feel like it wouldn't be too incongruent.
No, I think it would fit in. And I think that's the feel he was going for with the song. So I think he nailed the feel. I think musically this song works. So let's talk lyrically about this song.
So what, Tracy, what year was Snack Time released?
2008.
Okay. So 13 years ago now. Long enough that, you know, things have changed, you know, things have changed even more since like the 90s or so.
Yes.
But it's, you know, I think probably the discussion of gender identity has really opened up in the last 5 years, I dare say.
I would agree. I might even put it back 10 years at most.
Yeah. But a little after this song was released. And I dare say the thing is, I think children often take their cues from their parents and, you know, things that they hear. So I would hazard that the children of today, by and large, the vast majority of them are probably a lot more accepting, like wouldn't make as big a deal out of someone, quote unquote, a boy wearing a girl's coat. But I certainly remember when I was a kid, this would be the kind of thing that would get all sorts of negative attention. So whether or not, you know, and the interesting thing is, I think my favorite part of this is that he's like, even though it's black and it fits me perfectly, he can tell he kind of likes the coat, right? He's like, I kind of like this coat, but I don't want to wear it because it's a girl's coat. And I know that's going to get negative attention thrown on me at the playground or whatever, you know, so it's interesting.
I see. Here's my problem with this song. Why? What is it about the coat? Because I get it. About the girls and like growing up, like, yes, girls' clothing versus boys' clothing. That was actually the insult on the playground, was like, you're wearing girls' clothing. Mm-hmm. Even if you weren't, that was the insult that was thrown at you, along with many others, and I remember them well. But yes, like, you weren't allowed to do that for whatever stupid reason we had back in the 80s. You were not allowed to do that. But coats, I don't think that coats are so gender specific that a person normally would have been able to tell the difference between a girl's coat and a boy's coat most of the time.
Well, Tracy, I was wondering the same thing. I think for women's coats versus men's coats, it might be a little more pronounced depending on like how they're tailored. But boys and girls' coats, I would agree. Usually a coat is a coat is a coat. Now, I just sent you in our chat a fan video someone made, and I like this idea. I think this might answer your question. It's a black coat, but the inside, the lining is pink.
Oh.
And the boy in the video is not happy about that. Now again, in recent years, outside even of gender identity, the whole idea that pink is quote-unquote a girl's color and blue is a guy's color, etc. We all know if you go far enough back, that was reversed in Western society. We could talk all day about this. It'd be really interesting to do so, actually. But, you know, I do think that, you know, that might be an example of something that would quote unquote identify it as a girl's coat.
That would be, I think, the only thing, honestly, that would specifically identify it in at least the age that I grew up as a girl's coat. Right. And I'm watching the video, by the way. The person that did that, great. I mean, obviously he did it for his kids as a joke for his kids. But love it. Absolutely love it. Great job, Scott Hayward. We should have had you on the show. I wish I had known this exists. We would have invited you on. but I, in today's culture, like, it does not age well. And I'm sure that Ed would recognize that these days. However, like, I, once again, I don't think there's a big enough difference with a girl's coat and a boy's coat. I almost think, like, he's just, that was his go-to for whatever reason in his life.
Well, and like Aaron said, I think there was a time, you know, historically, where that was an issue, where a boy might have thought about that, where a boy might have said, I'm not going to wear, you know, girls' clothes, that kind of thing. So I think that was the where he was going with this. I don't think he was thinking about the stance of, like, the woke culture or what we would think of today's culture, which is that, you know, that might be, you know, that it's different today, basically.
But maybe... maybe Ed was the beginning of woke culture.
Maybe.
He was like, you know what? He was actually, with this song, highlighting the absurdity of child logic of
right.
you and I
yeah.
both
yeah.
know it's a girl's coat.
I think that there's probably some truth in that. And again, I kind of went back and forth until I just kind of said to myself, Aaron, you're way overthinking this song off the kids' album.
No, you're not, though. I thought that, too, when I first listened to it. I was like, oh, that, I don't know if you want to say that. You know?
Well, see, it's really interesting. Like I said, I think it's interesting that he sort of implies that he likes the coat.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But then he ends that first verse with, and I think the punctuation of the music where it lands on that tonic in the minor key. And he's like, you and I both know that's a girl's coat. You know, just like really argumentative and defensive. It's kind of like, again, and again, don't want to overanalyze, but the whole concept of toxic masculinity, it kind of reminded me of Walter White saying, I am the danger. You know what
yeah,
I mean?
Right.
Who are you trying to convince?
What I love about today's culture is, you're right, I work in a school, and I will say right. there are days that I've worn pink. There are certain kids that, yes, they are very rigid about the color scheme thing. I've worn pink to school, and I've been talking with kids, and I'm like, you know, some people don't like it when I wear this. They're like, why? And like they, right. to them, it's a total shock of like, pink isn't a male color. Like you can't wear
the whole,
pink. Like
the whole pink and blue thing, right? Yeah,
slur behavior.
Yeah,
which is great. Like great, we're breaking that slowly over time with that, you know, with attention to it, and not letting that become a major piece. And then we'll come back to that also with a major.
Well, and the whole thing too, which I've found in my own experience is Well, and the whole stereotype too, that boys don't play with dolls, girls don't play with trucks, that kind of thing too, you know, in reality, we see that's not true. We see that, you know, boys are perfectly fine playing with dolls, and I don't think they should be told not to, and vice versa. And, you know, you kind of see that. We have it ingrained in our heads that there's a certain set of rules that boys and girls have to follow as kids. And, I can see that in this song, because I do feel like he kind of is hinting that, like you've said, he likes his coat. It fits great. I like the color. You know, there's that little bit of kind of a nod that, you know, maybe this is something that should be okay.
Well, it goes back to the invention of the G.I. Joe, right?
Yeah.
Because, like, guys, you know, boys are playing with dolls. And the toy company said, oh, well, this is a whole other 50% of the market we could be selling to. So let's make dolls for boys, but we'll call them action figures, right? So we can't call them dolls. It's still a doll. It's just a doll
it's
with a
doll.
Gun instead of a hairbrush. You know what I mean? So, like, yeah. It's,
Yeah, actually, good friends of mine, the Library Bards, with Bonnie Gordon, they did a great song. They did a parody of Barbie Girl. Not that anyone would ever do a parody of Barbie Girl.
No.
But they did a they did a parody called Geeky Girl. And they talked about that, too, that with girls, same thing, that a lot of the superhero, the comic figures are geared towards boys when girls want to play with that too. So they're like, okay, well, we'll give you, you know, Leia, we'll give you, you know, Black Widow, we'll give you these and that. But, you know,
right.
That whole idea that
yeah, it comes full circle.
Right. Kids should not be limited to what they want to play with because we don't know, you know, down the road where their inclinations are going to lie, kind of thing. So,
and even before we started to have a better understanding as a culture about transgender and all of the different, just about being who you are and accepting who you are and who other people are. I mean, I have always thought, like, it's really absurd that our cultural norms say that girls can wear boys' clothes, boys can't wear girls' clothes.
Like, yeah, right.
Why can't boys wear women's pants? I mean, come on.
Women's pants make Steve dance. We're not singing songs about no women's pants. He got them size 14, a ladies' jeans.
That's enough, thank you.
women's pants, so where's the crime in loving women's pants? Well, you're not a chick, you've got...
Guys! Oh man, I don't feel so well.
Right.
Well, not only that, but all kinds of little boxes that we put people in, or expectations we place upon people. This whole discussion reminded me of when I was probably 12 or 13. I wasn't like crazy old, but we were in the grocery store and I asked my mom if I could get this toy, and she was like, "Aren't you getting a little old for toys?" You know. And of course, now that I'm in my 30s, I have more toys than I ever had when I was. So. I mean, some of them are, you know, like, you know, gear and stuff like that. But, you know, some of them are legitimate toys. I have a bigger video game collection than I did when I was a kid. So, yeah, I think, and to that point, video games are now the most profitable entertainment industry in the world, more than movies or TV or anything else. So, yeah, I think that as a society as a whole, I think we are transitioning away from this concept of kind of uniformity and conformity. And, you know, it's interesting because America's always supposedly been about the rugged individual and expressing yourself and just kind of being yourself. But as we kind of, you know, progress through these issues, these issues are coming to light that, hey, we still do have a lot of pressure on us to fit into certain boxes and to act in certain ways. And, you know, people are starting to rebel and push back against that. And it's just kind of interesting to see how those things change over time.
Mm-hmm.
And this is one of those discussions where I hope that Heidi sends us her thoughts, because I would love to hear.
Yeah,
her
right. Yeah. Yeah.
I was just thinking, I wish Bex could have been here for this one.
Mm, that would be great as well.
Well, yeah, them. And we know, and Go we know them. She loves this song, so I'd be curious to know what she thinks. Yeah.
And so if in fact Heidi did send us her thoughts, I will paste them in right here.
Hi, so my thoughts on My Big Sister. I know everybody's just on edge waiting for Heidi's thoughts on My Big Sister. And for me, it's just a short little under a minute long piece of childhood brilliance, because I was the oldest of four. So him and we were very, very poor growing up, and hand-me-downs were definitely a thing. And my youngest brother, I'm sure, would have taken hand-me-downs for certain things. But when it comes to a coat, like, you think, oh, it's just a coat and it's black, so you can just wear that coat. And I would never have handed down a shirt, because, you know, that says girl, or jeans or sandals, because, you know, sparkly sandals or girly looking sandals, you know, we don't think that's, you know, to be gender specific for boys. We don't think that would be, you know, accepted by them. Well, for some boys, they would love to borrow their sister's clothes, I'm sure. But the idea of a coat, like you think, well, it's just a coat. It's a black coat. Everybody, you know, it'll keep you warm. That's all that it's for. You know, you'll take it off and then the rest of your clothes are fine. And he's like, yeah, and I love her, but I don't want her coat. Can I have my own coat? And, you know, the idea of, yeah, you can give me balls and toys and games, and but a coat, that's kind of over the line. And I just love the simplicity of it, because it's like, I love her, but I don't want her stuff. Which is, it's just so simple of a thought. And it's like just a dark little thought moment where you can see the kid sulking in his room. And he's like, well, I love my sister. And, you know, it's not that I don't love her. It's not that I don't care about her. But my mom wants me to have her coat because we can't afford to go out and get another coat. Or I grew out of my coat so fast. And maybe it's only for like 5 minutes, you know, we're going to go get you a new coat. But for today, can you wear that? It's black, dude. It's black. Nobody's going to know it's a girl's coat, but he knows it's a girl's coat. And so that idea of going to school and having one kid maybe go, that's a girl's coat, dude. That's a girl's coat. I can see definitely how that would be impactful for a little kid. And so it's just kind of that sulking in my room song. I mean, it's not as good as Bad Day. Like, in my opinion, I think that's one of the best childhood songs of ever. Like, not, it doesn't come close to some of They Might Be Giants stuff, but I still think Bad Day is one of the best kid songs. But my big sister is just one of those little thoughts. Like, the kid goes up to his room because his mom said, can you just wear your sister's coat to school today until we find your coat or until we go and get you a new coat? So that's that. Those are my thoughts. But I would rate it. It's not the greatest song. I think I would rate it like a 3.6, 3.7. Because obviously it doesn't come close to anything else, but I still do really like the song.
Wow, that was really interesting how Heidi had those thoughts or didn't.
That was amazing, Heidi. Well said. Even had the mic drop at the end. That was great.
So we've covered, well, actually we covered for Aaron. I did not have,
we have a Stefan.
Not that I don't want Stefan, but I was like, oh wow, look at that, that's timing.
Can we get another straight white man in here? Let's diversify.
That's great, because that is the perspective that we really needed tonight. Kind of brings us home.
Need some diversity in here.
Yeah, absolutely.
When you live in Maine, it's hard to get diversity.
That's true.
Just cross the street for it.
There are pockets of diversity. I was very fortunate that the high school I went to had a lot of exchange students, and I got to go to school with kids from all across the world. That was really interesting, actually. In retrospect.
Your school was really great about that.
Oh, yeah. Everyone hates high school, and I did when I was in it, but I look back on those times now a lot more fondly. I'm sure that high school me would strangle current me for saying that, but, I'm sure that a significant amount of that is nostalgia, and a significant amount is, adult problems versus kid problems, like we had talked about earlier. But, no, I really do feel very fortunate to have gone there in particular and met the people I did and had the experiences I did.
Greetings, Stefan.
Stefan, you with us? Can you hear us?
Hello. Hopefully you guys can hear me.
We can hear you.
We can hear you, sir.
Oh, good. Oh, that's fantastic.
So we've been talking ad nauseum for the last half hour about this song. What are your thoughts on this song?
Are you wearing a girl's coat, Stefan?
It's the girl's coat that kind of threw me off. of all the different directions you could go with, I like my big sister. Wearing her clothing is not what I had in mind. I don't have a big sister or a little sister. So, as far as the coat, as far as the song, very simple. I thought it was kind of a strange direction for them to go in. Who am I to judge?
Well, that's kind of been the discussion we've also been having tonight. It's like, who are we to judge on that?
Yeah. I don't know what they were thinking, but there's lots of other directions you could go with that.
Well, I think Ed was trying to write something to his experience, and he is the youngest of four children, two of which are our sisters. I'm sure that he had to deal with a lot of hand-me-downs, and considering he lives in Canada, in Ontario, like, I'm sure winter coats especially were hand-me-downs quite often. They're not the cheapest piece of clothing in the world.
Oh, winter coats are really, really expensive. At least $100 or more.
So I actually say to his parents, good job for doing hand-me-downs on those, by the way. That means that the kids kept
But shirts and sandals are out of bounds.
Yes.
Probably means quite a bit of picking on as a young man who's trying to find his own identity. in grade school or in high school.
Yeah, I just this whole thing just reminded me of Harry Potter, where Ron Weasley gets picked on for wearing hand-me-downs. That's an issue in itself. That's a classist kind of thing, I think.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's a really good point, too. Like, we've talked about the different pieces of this, but classist is another big thing. Like, there are, especially in the areas that I came from, like, it was a big deal to not have a lot of money, and that was one of the ways that families were picked on. Like, oh, you're wearing a hand-me-down. That's, or you're wearing something from, well, at that time it was like Kmart. You're wearing something from one of those lower stores. How dare you?
Yeah. Oh, no, this is also before the trend of thrift store shopping really kind of kicked in.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's probably because a lot of us went through that. Like, I know when I buy for my kids, like, I'm often having that discussion with my family of, like, what's wrong with Walmart clothes? Like, I'm fine with Walmart clothes. Other than the fact from it's Walmart, like, I don't mind if it's cheap as long as it gets me through the day and it looks okay.
They're not bad in style either. You can do a lot with that. Most of my clothes are Walmart clothes, but I do get picked on. Mostly by you, Tracy.
Yes. Which is ironic.
Isn't it ironic? Don't you
think? Don't you think?
Yes.
Another Canadian great.
I love Celine Dion.
Oh. Wow.
Wow. You got a wow in stereo.
Oh, bro. Man. The way you just pissed off Anne Murray right now.
Jeff, how dare you? Joni Mitchell is really angry at you.
Oh, man.
Okay. How many more Canadians can we truly...
Seriously, though, it was Justin Bieber. But we know it was Justin Bieber. That's it was the Biebs.
I always thought it was
Bryan Adams.
Yeah, never mind. Yeah, Bryan Adams. The one true Canadian.
Now, the Canadian government has apologized for Bryan Adams many times.
He's still cutting albums, too. I believe.
Oh, yeah.
Now that you can find them on AllMusic, because he pulled all the reviews, but.
I'll tell you, I cut his albums all the time. Whenever I get a chance. Man. Oh, so I was about to throw this over to you, Jeff, to do some ratings. So what do we have tonight?
Oh my gosh, I have no idea.
Coats,
yeah. Now let's do G.I. Joes. Let's do 0 to 5 G.I. Joes.
I like that.
And Stefan. How about you go first?
Sure. I hope you guys can still hear me. You guys were kind of breaking up just a little bit. I like the beat. The singing is good. The lyrics, I'm not sure about. I think it could have been a little bit better as far as that goes, I guess. I don't know. The lyrics really left me speechless because I'm like, why of all directions to go and why this way? How about my sister is great. We don't get along, but I still love her. I don't know. you know, I haven't flushed your head down the toilet yet. I all kinds of things that I could think of in regards to having a big sister. Anyways, I'm going to rank this probably 2 G.I. Joes.
Wow, okay.
Okay, 2. All right.
2 G.I. Joes. Probably like a Zartan and like a Snake Eyes.
Oh, wow. You threw a Zartan in
there. That was a deep. That was a deep cut. Wow.
Not only was it a deep cut, but he's not giving much flout to that 2 G.I. Joes.
Zartan was the dude. He everywhere wanted him. He changed color.
That's true. Okay, you know what? You just made an excellent point. I always thought, like, on the TV show, Zartan was the lower class character that no one really like. He was always undercut and ignored and such. But I think that, you know what? I think you're right in terms of action figures, in terms of dolls. Zartan was the better doll.
Absolutely. I know I wanted him as a kid.
All right, Aaron, we haven't heard from you in a while. How about you go next?
Well, you know, I like that it's minor. I like that it's kind of enigmatic. The music for me is really, really good. I think it's musically one of the better kid songs that we've heard. And then, you know, the lyrics, a little out of left field, but especially after the conversation we just had, I think it's kind of definitely interesting and definitely worth a listen. So I'm going to go ahead and give my big sister 3.5 G.I. Joes. Why don't we say, I don't know, Hawk, Gung Ho, Snake Eyes, definitely, and maybe
and
half a bear.
And
half
Hawk-
a Baroness.
Oh, Baroness. I was going to say you were going to go with like Hawk's animal creature there, but well,
okay,
Hawk.
That could be half. That could be half.
Baroness.
All right, Tracy, you are up.
So I've thought really hard on this song. The dark tones are really great. And I think that as a country western type dark in kind of feel, it is good. But I was the oldest child and I had no big sister or little sister even. And my kids themselves don't even like that. The older child is the son, the younger one's the daughter. So like hand-me-downs work perfectly fine in that direction as well. And hopefully in today's culture, even then I've tried to encourage that, like, it doesn't matter one way or the other. So, you know, this topic doesn't really capture that for me. Like Stefan said, I would have liked to have seen a different variation of this song done with the same dark themes on that love-hate relationship that siblings have. Like, that would have been a really cool way to address my big sister. It's okay. It's not one that's in my playbook. It's not one that I have the kids listen to. And speaking of the kids, I'll have their thoughts next. But I'm going to give this a 2.9 G.I. Joes. So I'm going to give it a Duke, who is the 0.9. Like he's not the fun G.I. Joe to play with.
wow.
I'm going to give him a Snake Eyes, and I'm going to give it a Destro.
Okay. All right.
Destro was, he was the go-getter. He really did. You know, he tried.
He was the one that did all the work.
Cobra Commander was just one of those useless managers that was like, you're not doing it well enough. It could never amount to
anything. Yeah, Destro was like the hand of the king. He did the real work.
Right.
Yeah.
The right hand man kind of guy, yeah.
He did the slapping.
We just made a G.I. Joe's Game of Thrones crossover reference, guys. So I'm really proud
that's,
of that.
That's where we go, though.
Yeah. Game of Joe's.
That's why Game of Joe's.
Okay, I guess I'll go. My daughter liked this song, actually. She really enjoyed it. I did write down, and I'm proud of myself, and I think it's the guitar playing and everything I've been doing over the last year or so. I did write down, this is a very I put down this is like a Harry Chapin kind of Cat Stevens song, which I believe Aaron mentioned, and I said, oh, this is a minor key. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
So I actually wrote those notes down. I like those stings and everything. It did hit me kind of weird that it did throw the whole I won't wear a girl's clothes down, and I think it's because my brain is so in I don't want to think like that anymore because, you know, my son at a very early age said, I want to wear a girl's clothes. I think I'm a girl. So, you know, my personal views get in there too, which is that things are different. But that said, I know when I was growing up in the 80s, it was... No, that was it. It was a different thing. I'm like, I'm not going to wear girls' clothes. But from a strictly song standpoint, this one doesn't really do it for me. And I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's it never really hits a good rhyme kind of thing going on. It never really rhymes. I mean, they rhyme coat with coat in 2 and 4. So I don't know. This one doesn't gel with me as much as I would like. It just doesn't quite hit me on the same level. So now, you might all take points away from me, but I never played with G.I. Joe. I literally know nothing about G.I. Joe. I played with He-Man. Oh. He-Man was my guy. So,
all right, so
I'm going to give.
He-Man. Go with He-Man.
I am going to go with He-Man. I am going to give this a 1.9 G.I. Joe / He-Man's. And since it's close to 2, I will do 2. I'm going to do a Skunkor and a Mossman.
Oh, wow.
Skunkor. I remember Skunkor.
He smelled like a skunk. Come on.
Yeah,
how could you not?
The figure actually smelled like a skunk.
He did.
My parents hated
it. I loved it. I had like the slime castle and everything. It was really.
No love for Storm Shadow. That's too bad.
Or Men-at-Arms, you know, or Orko, but what, you know, but.
I guess Orko would be a 0.9.
Oh, I was talking back about G.I.
Okay, Bella, what do you think of the song My Big Sister?
I think it's a little bit short.
Okay. And what did you like about it? Nothing that you really liked about it? Was there anything that you didn't like about it?
How it was pretty short.
Okay. What did you think the song was about?
It was about him not wanting a coat from his older sister.
Why wouldn't he want a coat from his older sister?
Because it's in the girl section.
Okay. So... 0 to 5.
Yeah.
What do you think about this song? 0 to 5, what do you give this song?
2.5.
Okay. Thank you.
But I have to point out, Jeff.
So
you were the one that chose G.I. Joe.
Because we talked. Because we mentioned it. It came up in the conversation.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So I like this more than all of you. It would seem. I like this one a lot. Like I said, I think initially the lyrical content might have been a negative for me, but I am inclined to believe that Ed was doing this kind of tongue-in-cheek. So
I agree.
After our conversation,
yeah.
I think it's a positive for me.
Yeah, I was going to say, I think he was very tongue-in-cheek. I think that was the intent.
Yeah.
But, you know, for me, it just didn't hit that way. It didn't kind of connect in a way I would have liked to, even as a children's song.
And I think most of the points I gave were for it musically. Like, musically, this song hits for
right.
me.
Yeah.
And I'm not a big country western type fan, but this song hits for me. This is something musically I would listen to if it just connected to me more.
It was great musically. Yeah. Sounded great.
Heidi, what did you think? What do you give this for a score? Spite sent him. She's sending her thoughts.
A five? Really?
Wow.
Wow, Heidi.
I was not.
Yeah, that was crazy. Way to bring the score up, Heidi. Good job. Yeah, that was good.
So, this week's They're Not Gonna Pay Us ad is for is for Big Brothers Big Sisters. They are a wonderful organization. Nice.
Good choice.
They help children in need to get the guidance and mentorship that they need. It's all about connections, which now more than ever is super important. And I don't just mean during the pandemic. I myself used to be a big brother. And though...
Me too.
Congratulations, then, sir. Mm-hmm. Through it, I was able to meet some really amazing families, people I never would have met otherwise because our spheres wouldn't have naturally crossed. But not only did I get to show these kids that not all males are the same and that pacifists can be just as kind and caring as military families mm-hmm. and understand them, but they also taught me a lot about empathy, which has become essential in my daily work life. And it's just a great cause. It's a great program, which is why even if they sent us money, I would not accept their money. Even if they offered to, which they won't, pay for this in advertisement.
So, Tracy, may I suggest a little audio bumper for that segment, by the way?
Sure.
They're not gonna pay us. No, they ain't gonna pay us. They're not gonna pay us ad time.
Nice. I love it.
I was worried because I thought you were gonna go with any more, and they hadn't paid us before.
They never paid us. They never will.
And speaking of Big Brothers Big Sisters, that's our new segue, by the way. And speaking of Big Brothers Big Sisters, this week's appearance was actually done to raise money for Big Brothers Big Sisters, interestingly enough. Nice. I'm going to reference this week's selfie cam jam cover of the classic hit High School Confidential, when Bare Naked Ladies actually worked together with Rough Trade, so Carol Pope and Kevin Staples, to cover High School Confidential, which was originally their song. We're not going to cover this song as an actual song on our list because it's not B&L and it's not really them covering the song so much as them singing it with Rough Trade during the pandemic. So that's kind of where we're going to go with it there. But I really do like recommend it. It's a nice kind of also, once again, minor key, kind of disparate kind of song that kind of challenges perceptions. So I recommend people going out and listening to that. Well, guys, we've talked a lot about tonight's song being kind of not as woke as we would like it. You might even say that in today's time, it might be considered narrow-minded.
Dear God.
Brought to you by Stretch Armstrong.
That's a better transition than mine. But next week, we're going to talk about other narrow things, such as narrow streets.
All righty.
I found a way to transition that one. That was hard.
You did. That was good. Yeah.
Thank you guys for joining me tonight. Really appreciate it.
Thanks, that was fun. Don't forget, no regrets. Except maybe one.
To talk to you.
Sometimes you have just one of those days.
Oh yeah. Today was the first day of school, all of those days.
Yeah, today was 12.
Oh yeah, that's right.
It was yesterday for us, but yeah.
So much fun.
And we had a half day because we're all flooded out down here.
Oh, that's right. Storm's headed our way now, so we'll see what's going on.
Yeah, they closed schools today because of the floods.
If we just keep blowing really hard, maybe it'll go south.
Just
everyone
keep on blowing, Tracy.
So many thoughts.
Oh, anyway, man. Maine just shot up way high on the Pornhub rankings.
Wow.
We're gonna have to cut all of this.
Always.
save it for the Patreon. Bare Naked ABCs After Dark.
So it would be called what? Tracy Blows Bare Naked Ladies?
No. Tracy.
Hey, Tracy. Whatever gets Ed on the show.
Oh, that just made them.
Ed, we know you listen. We're not making any promises specifically, but we're not making promises.
Ed, please come on the show. Those are up.
To celebrate joining Pantheon Podcasts, Rock Camp, the podcast, the official podcast of Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp, is giving away a guitar signed by Mike Portnoy of Dream Theater, Marty Friedman, formerly of Megadeth, and legendary shredder Zakk Wylde, plus our rock star counselors like Vinny Appice, Monty Pittman, and more. To enter to win, simply follow, rate, and review our podcast on your preferred platform, and that's all you have to do. For more information, go to rockcamp.com/podcast.